Beethoven Sonata Opus 31, Number 2, with the title Tempest. Beethoven once was asked what was his intention about composing this piece, and he just said, read The Tempest of Shakespeare. And in all the last decades, there have been a lot of books and thinking about this title and what you really can find from the Shakespeare play here in this sonata. And I think it's not important to find connections between the text and a special bar in Beethoven, but it just creates this atmosphere. And in Tempest of Shakespeare, Ariel says, hell is empty and the devils are all here. And there are some passages where you could imagine this. And also Beethoven is supposed to have said, hier muss es ordentlich krachen. You have to do a lot of noise here. And but we should always have in mind that there are some really loud passage with great expression, but they are still in forte. Fortissimo is not everywhere, so be careful not to destroy the piano. And the second movement is a wonderful, I think, a dialogue between a kind of innocent espressivo melody and chords in between, and also some kind of timpanis in between, which create an atmosphere, kind of three-dimensional listening. And the last movement is one of the most famous movements of Beethoven, and but it is written allegretto and not allegro con brio or even faster, like it is sometimes played. And you showed in your wonderful performance that it is possible to really make out a great interpretation and to look at the allegretto. You are 16 years old, and you gave me such a pleasure in all the lessons, and also my colleagues in different commissions listening to you. I would just like to ask you, what is important for the interpretation for first movement, second movement, third movement? What is in your mind playing?
First of all, I think the most important thing for the first movement is you have to make the contrast between the forte and the piano, or the pianissimo, because the title of the sonata is the Storm Sonata. And then it is quite so special because this piece is begins with the dominant, the A major. So it's, this thing never happened in his sonata before.
Yeah. And it is just kind of open.
Open.
You don't know what happened. It's a question mark.
Yeah. And then the Storm comes here.
Yes.
Yeah. But nobody knows that this piece is in D minor. But they know when this passage arrives. It's like the first recognition that this piece is in D minor key. Yeah. And also,
what do you think about the development?
The development.
Well, we have always the same, but we have different chords.
Yeah,
and
we
different
have
keys.
I think it has more intention, more intense. The chord is more intense than the D minor, I think.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then.
Well, and the recitativo with
recitativo.
The famous pedal section.
Yeah.
Just play it. Again, we have listened to the performance.
Yeah. I think this passage is really special passage in this sonata.
Yeah. It is like a voice coming from heaven from anywhere, and you can't identify what really happens. And it sometimes reminds me on kind of recitativi in Mozart operas. When Tamino is asked, and they don't know what will happen, and then it said it's not allowed to talk about what will happen. And or a recitativo in one of the Bach Passions, something like this. Well, how do you do the pedal there? It's just one pedal written, and it's always a discussion what to do.
I do with the one pedal, actually. And then I have some special thing this you told or you already told me when I play this passage, I need to keep the bass, my left hand. Mm-hmm.
And then you slightly can move the pedal.
Yeah, I can move the pedal a bit. Because if I place my left hand on a keyboard, the sound will be sustained, automatically sustained.
It's a very interesting fact that I have an edition of Ignaz Moscheles. And Ignaz Moscheles was not only a very good composer and a fantastic pianist, but he was a friend of Beethoven. And they exchanged letters. He did an edition of all the Beethoven sonatas, and I here have one print, which is sure before 1863, because there is written a name of an owner, 1863. And, Moscheles just writes, after the chord, he writes pedal end. Very strange, of course. And here, at the end of the whole movement, he just writes one pedal in D minor. And of course, we could say later all the checking of sources and tradition and thinking about have created this moment where we have this pedal. But a friend of Beethoven who gave this edition, he really said, leave the pedal.
Leave the pedal.
Very interesting, but of course, we cannot follow this anymore. Because behind us is the tradition of hundreds of years and hundreds of great pianists who did something with the pedal. And we have such things also in Haydn C major sonata, where there is this moment with where it's written open pedal.
I see.
And then it sounds maybe a little bit like this. And but I think your pianissimo comes out really very, very good. And I like this very much. What about the end of the first movement? So the music almost disappears, and their technical approach should be just doing nothing, like cleaning the dust from the keyboard, and it's a little bit like in Opus 111 at the end.
I think in this case it has some feeling of the strong feeling.
Yes.
Yeah, because
still,
you have, it's not quite a peaceful ending.
This is a very good argument. And I know you do it like this. Very good. Second movement, what
second
is this?
Second movement. I think it's like the day after the storm in the second movement. And it has, as you say, so many characters. It has the sweet voice.
So not the calm before the storm, but the calm after the storm.
After the storm,
And what is this with this wonderful melody in the right hand, and which is in contrast?
It's in contrast with the tremolo in. It's kind of reminded the storm happened in the first movement.
So kind of echo of this emotion.
Of
And Do you think that one should have a big difference in sound between this melody and the harmony? Could you just play the first line again? Okay. If you have this sforzato, I would do it a little bit more. Yes, it's okay. A kind of real pain. Yes.
Ah.
Can you do maybe a little bit before from here? One could discuss, really. And here we have the same situation we talked about in Opus 26.
Yeah.
This kind of crescendo and then sudden piano.
Yeah.
Normally you would expect another accent, but then it goes back.
It's like the surprise for the audience.
Right? Yes, yep. Yes, maybe. Or later, here we have the crescendo and sforzato and piano and crescendo again. Can you show this? Yes. Yeah. So it's always also a kind of moving of emotion. Like this. And very special is the end, where we have this really very, I think even written quite complicated. We have this crescendo and then piano. Yeah. And it is a semi quaver, so yeah. It must be quite short. Two notes you play the C, but the one is in crescendo and the other is in piano. Can you show it? Yeah. Well, maybe one could even discuss to make the rhythm sharper. So it comes a little bit faster because it's a kind of double point. Yeah, but and then piano.
Okay.
Yes. Yeah. And then the music disappears. One would expect. Something. But it's just one note. What is your feeling for third movement? Would you like to take quite a big break that the audience can take out the program or coughing or whatever? Or would you like to do it more attacca?
It's not so attacca actually, but I don't want to take so long time between the second and third movements.
Yeah. Would you like to show your idea? Maybe the last.
Yes.
yes, yes. What do you think? Is it a kind of relaxed quietness, or is it in the sense of Schubert Gretchen am Spinnrad?
No.
Which is a quite, meine Ruhe ist hin, mein Herz ist schwer, my quietness is disappeared and my heart is full of sorrow. What do you think? What happens there?
I think it's a bit so sorrow, a bit so painful here.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, I think the tempo is a bit like the waltz. But it's in some very painful way.
Yes, yeah, very painful way, which has later a kind of breakout.
Yeah.
Here when the B flat major comes. Yeah.
Uh-huh. So I think one of the most important passages in this movement is the moment when the B flat minor is coming.
Yes.
Sorry,
B flat minor, of course.
B-flat
yeah.
Minor.
Nice. Can you show this moment? Where here when it's really strong. Later we have some harmonic changes, which mm-hmm. are kind of surprise.
Uh-huh.
I think for example here, and we have we have also this surprising range of dynamics. We have a pianissimo,
and then
suddenly, can you start a little bit before to show it? Now the end, which is really wonderful,
yeah.
And it is another sonata like the sonata of Sayoko with mm-hmm. Opus 26, which just disappears in nowhere. Yeah. It's like open.
It's quite
window.
An extraordinary feeling.
Yes, yes.
I think
and
yeah.
Interesting that there is a triplet at the end.
Yeah.
So it is so. Much pianissimo and piano that one cannot follow the rhythm, it just disappears. Yeah.
Yeah. And I want to show something. The passage I like the most in this moment is the passage when the B flat minor arrives.
Yes. Can you do a little bit before?
Okay.
So that we can hear this change?
Thank you.
So it is a sonata with the greatest, biggest, and heaviest possible contrast, from pianissimo to shouting fortissimo, and very, very big chords, and but also extremely sensitive pianissimo and handling of the pedal. Yeah. Thank you very much. And this was a wonderful performance, and I'm happy that you really know what you do. Thank you.
Okay, thank you so much.